Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I think we should start. It's just past 2 o'clock. And I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you to this session, which is, I would say, slightly different. I think it'll be a very interesting session for you. It's very much a product of the work of UEG. And I'm going to just say a few words in the beginning just to explain to you how it all came together so that you'll begin to understand how, as we progress through the next 90 minutes, what it's all about. The Future Trends Committee was started in 2010, and when I joined as president-elect in 2012, there was one big challenge on the table, which was to commission a survey of gastrointestinal diseases in Europe to look at the economic burden, to provide us with absolute up-to-date information so that we could use this information to make the case for improved services and to invest more into research. And we just needed up-to-date information that would allow us to do that. So we commissioned this survey of digestive health. I'm delighted that the first speaker after me, John Williams, will be telling you in some detail about that survey and its results, some of the high spots and indeed some of the low spots in terms of where we are in terms of disease burden and healthcare delivery. The second task that the Future Trends Committee took on was to think much further ahead. John will show you data which will allow us to forecast for perhaps up to 5 years. But anything beyond that, using static data becomes very unreliable. And so what we did was to use a scenario planning methodology to think much further ahead, to think what it might be like in 2040. And if any of you are wondering why we think 2040 might be important, just think for a moment. The students that you admitted to your medical schools this year will only be halfway through their medical careers in 2040, halfway through, on the understanding that most of them won't be retiring until they're in their 80s. That's the way it's going, I'm afraid. But so it is absolutely right that at this moment in time, we think about what it's going to be like in 2040, because we have to prepare this cohort of new doctors to deal with those changes, to be perhaps more flexible than many of us have been in our approach to our careers and to our practice. We want to understand now, here today, what is the current burden of disease. We want to understand how services vary across Europe, and we also want to understand what the economic burden is. So we formally started this project in 2013. We had a competition, an open competition, John and his team at Swansea University School of Medicine, College of Medicine, won the competition and have done the work. The important thing for us as an organization is that we are the United Voice of Europe for gastroenterology and hepatology. If anybody can go to Brussels and tell the health commissioner and tell other interested politicians the way it is and how it should be, it is us. And similarly, for those of you who go back to your national societies, you will also want to know what we are saying as a body in Europe overall and how you can modify that and tailor that to what is required in your own countries. So that is vital. In terms of the scenario planning, we joined up with a professional group, the Norman Partners. They're based in Oxford and also in Sweden, international group. They are the professionals. They taught us how to do it, and we'll come back to that in a moment. So for the next 90 or so minutes, we're going to think about the past, and that is the data that we've accumulated and that John has looked at over the last 5 or 10 years. We clearly are going to look at that today in the present, but we're also going to fast track you forward to 2040. We want to start a debate. We want to begin to think and look at healthcare in a different way. We want to be free to imagine, and you'll see these scenarios are about imagination, not just data collection, about imagination. And we hope that they'll refocus our priorities for the future and ultimately change the way we think. So, John, with that, I want to ask you to come to the podium and tell us about the work you've done over the last year or so. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, the year is 2040. The last decades have seen Europe in a significant decline. Impoverishment is widespread. Public health care no longer exists, and we now see a two-tier medicine. But why has this occurred? Well, over the last 25 years, Europe has seen a dramatic downturn, referred to many as the Ice Age. External influences such as the depletion of natural resources, catastrophic events in climate change, wars, terrorism, have all added a significant burden on Europe. The population has changed. People and industries have moved away from Europe. The population that remains is elderly. And all of these lead to economic crisis and impoverishment across Europe. The European Union no longer exists. Unemployment is high. Most of the population is poor. Deregulation has meant that the population is now exposed to environmental hazards. Religious groups and alternative health sects are on the rise. So what does this mean for healthcare provision? Well, the economic depletion means that there are now limited public finances, and the money is held by the rich few, by individuals, by enterprises, by private healthcare insurance companies. Society is now split into the rich that can afford healthcare and into the poor that have to access what is left of the original public healthcare. So who are these rich? Well, these are the well-off, middle to high-income individuals, those that can buy healthcare, and those that work for companies that have this as benefits. Now, these individuals can access elite health. What is elite health? Elite health is that has benefited from researches, from advances in technologies. But this comes at a high cost, and those individuals who have chronic illnesses are unable to sustain access to this high-cost care and gradually drift away. But those that can afford it, they enjoy good health. They enjoy good health to an elderly age. However, they remain susceptible to increased drug resistance, to infectious diseases, to new age illnesses, and to increases in psychological conditions, the so-called well sick. But that is the minority of people. What about the majority of people? The so-called poor. These are those on low to middle incomes, those who work in public sectors, and the so-called neglected populations. Although there is some money which trickles gradually from the rich to the poor side, this is insufficient. And therefore, these individuals have to access economy health. Economy health where resources are poor, where diagnosis and treatment is both delayed and substandard, and they suffer bad health. There is an increase in diseases related to substance abuse. There is an increase in diseases related to malnutrition, both undernutrition and obesity. And depression is common. So these individuals turn to self-care, often web-based. They turn to alternative healthcare, which works in a deregulated system, often run by entrepreneurs. This increases drug resistance and susceptibility to infectious diseases, putting further burden on public healthcare, which has now collapsed. So what does this mean for the individual patient? Well, let's follow the patient, aged 50 with colorectal cancer. And it really depends on which pathway he follows. If we were to follow the rich pathway, he presents with symptoms, perhaps a change in bowel habit or blood in the stool. He's able to access primary care or indeed specialist care. He gets explorations within days, within weeks, and a diagnosis is rapidly made. A multidisciplinary specialist team is convened that carries out a pre-treatment workup looking at the severity and extent of disease. And they're able to use the latest technologies to start effective treatment. So therefore, treatment is early, and post-treatment surveillance is robust. And not only does the patient benefit, but his family is able to undergo surveillance as well. Contrast this with the poor pathway, where access to healthcare is much more difficult. These individuals may not be able to access primary care or specialist care. Symptoms are often neglected. They then turn to the web-based to try and manage their symptoms. But this only works to delay the diagnosis, and eventually these individuals become more sick. They then access public health care, or what is left of it, as an emergency. But resources are poor there. Diagnosis is still delayed. Treatment is still substandard. And the likelihood that they have developed metastatic disease is much higher, and therefore the outcomes for these individuals is much worse. So these are significant implications for healthcare, significant implications for the individual patient. But what about healthcare professionals? Well, what we actually see is that doctors and other healthcare professionals are leaving Europe. They're seeking better working conditions. They're seeking access to the latest technologies and treatments. They're seeking work in specialist centers which now exist outside Europe. This is almost a reverse of the brain drain that brought so many doctors to Europe in the early part of the 21st century. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Ice Age. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Silicon Age. The Silicon Age is all about technology. We have used the advancements in technology, in science, and social interactions. We have created a healthcare system where, depending heavily on extensive automation of diagnosis and treatments, we have directed health behavior towards self-monitoring and preventive medicine and self-cure, resulting overall in a positive change in healthcare. During the Silicon Age, global trends and crises, including a growing and aging population, as well as migration from developing countries, have led to changes in individual behavior and social priorities, in industrial strategies and governmental policies towards finding a solution to the increasing healthcare expenditures. And the population growth has encouraged innovation. There's a widespread acceptance of technology as the and e-health and self-monitoring as the major means of healthcare and disease control. At the same time, social media has become highly influential, being capable of driving healthcare and developments in directions decided by social networks. The European Union is still existent and has, in fact, promoted these developments, by modernizing health legislation across Europe, as well as setting standards for care. However, access to healthcare is not equal. There's still a large non-EU immigrant population relying on social security and potentially draining resources from the system. The Silicon Age came to be because of growth in the economy and thereby an exponential growth in technology, in medical science, and data management. In order to reduce the increasing costs and increasing efficiency, there were private and public partnerships, as well as collaborative ventures, who drove the developments of high-tech, low-cost solutions, and ending with automations of diagnosis and treatments, introducing robotics into the healthcare system, and also introducing the need for self-monitoring of the patients. By the developments in social media, the health behavior changed as well towards this self-monitoring, self-cure, and in the end, a system with preventive medicine. Introductions of technologies and advances in current technologies is driven mostly and extremely by the opportunity to gain profit and by opinions created by the social media networks. And in the Silicon Age, the healthcare system is characterized by automatic robotic care, by high-tech personalized medicine, ranging from app-like solutions to expensive boutiques and healthcare stations, but also a fragmentation of the healthcare systems, which is driven by public and private and social media interests. A patient with colorectal cancer in the Silicon Age begins its journey already at birth. Every person will have a health risk passport created after birth based on genomic screening. And at the age of 25, this screening and this risk will be adjusted. The risk for several diseases will be adjusted using both the genomic risk data, but also combining it with data on lifestyle and environmental factors, which have been accumulated throughout these years, based on self-monitoring devices and solutions, as well as governmental databases. Based on this risk profile, the patient will eventually be eligible for insurance coverage and will then enter into a personalized screening program, including, for instance, blood samples taken at home using a variety of devices, which will then prompt further investigations, if needed, at healthcare stations, which are found everywhere around the corner in supermarkets, for instance. And this will, in the end, mean that the mortality and occurrence of colorectal cancer in the Silicon Age for patients eligible for insurance coverage will have decreased. On the other hand, if the patient is ineligible for insurance coverage, the risk is too high, the lifestyle is not good enough, screening will be based on a standard plan and also very much on the person's own motivation for screening, for instance. For this category of patients, the incidence and mortality of colorectal cancer is either unchanged compared to the beginning of the millennium or has even increased. For the doctors, the roles has changed significantly before entering the Silicon Age. The doctors are not any longer the first place to be referred to when having diseases, because all of this is taken care of using self-monitoring and e-health. But doctors are more health coaches, consultants, who can help the patients or the people navigate and understand the vast amount of data being collected on the patients and understand the personal patient cloud records. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to 2040. Welcome to the United States of Europe. Welcome to the Golden Age. Over the last 25 years, Europe was able to develop a strong, well-coordinated, unified government. And in terms of healthcare, we were able to ensure high-quality healthcare for all European citizens. Europe has been facing in the past 25 years an influx of immigrants, widespread cross-border movements of people, and this has resulted in a more multicultural but united Europe. The United States of Europe do not have any more national borders, have been able to homogenize the education, taxation, and legislation systems, and have been able to afford universal access to healthcare for all the citizens. It's true, economic growth has slowed. There have been environmental issues, but the government was able to tackle these issues and to push preventive medicine into its agenda. We are now in a period of peace and stability and a golden age for Europe. Let us review which were the factors that led to these changes all over Europe. Europe was facing very severe issues like climate changes, global warming, with the consequent pressure on the economics and the environment. There were also migratory fluxes from all different countries to Europe, and this was associated with low economic growth and demographic changes, putting a lot of pressure on single states within the EU. It derived that there was an urgent need for a more stringent legislation and European economic governance. Europe was able to respond to these issues, to these challenges, by implementing a more stringent legislation Europe-wide. There was the collapse of European borders among states. Taxation and budget was controlled at a supranational levels. And this, together with technological advances, brought about a homogenization of the healthcare and educational system and led to a generalized medicine with the help of e-health. On the other side, the strong government was able to make the industry and the food industry to adapt to more stringent requirements, for example, obliging food industries to control the amount of calories present into the food. And lately, there was the birth of the United States of Europe, the political entity that is associated with this very strong government. What happens to the patient pathway in this golden age? The patient is managed both at a very local and a very Europe-wide transnational level. For example, a patient from the UK that develops symptoms might go to the local pharmacy to get his blood drawn to be sent to a centralized lab. A diagnosis is made, first of microcytic anemia, and then via a virtual exam, for example, a capsule endoscopy that is being read somewhere else, for example, in the Netherlands, a diagnosis of colon cancer is made. Now, with the help of the e-health, the patient receives a genetic profiling of the tumor, but also a pharmacogenomic profiling that is combined. And according to the most recent trials, it is determined that the best treatment for the patient, the state-of-the-art treatment for the patient, would be to receive a given anti-cancer agent, KJX, before surgery. This would maximize his or her chances for success in terms of outcome. However, based on the fact that this specific patient has only a moderate chance of response to this very expensive drug, the United States of Europe have a policy and standardization of healthcare that does not allow reimbursement of this given drug in this given patient. So the patient is treated with a more conventional way, for example, with surgery and adjuvant treatment, and maybe, unfortunately, his outcome is not very good with recurrence and metastasis. So it is a golden age, but on the other side, it might be a sort of tarnished gold, because we might understand that the provision of healthcare for all citizens might come at the expense of not having the ability to afford state-of-the-art treatment for all the patients. What will be the role of the doctor in this condition? The doctor will have to maintain a traditional role, but they will have to cope with the input coming from e-health platforms. And more important, will have their autonomy conditioned to a certain extent by this very strong government that will not allow prescription of some drugs in certain conditions. Thank you.
So, excellent presentations and different scenarios that you provided us with. I mean, in the future, there probably will be aspects of all of these scenarios in the future healthcare. Did you have a chance to discuss the most likely development within Europe in the coming 15 years, apart from these extremes? Any comments about that?
I think that you have already suggested us with the more likely answer. Probably not all of this, no of these scenarios will be exactly the same, as we presented. It's like more, as Michael said, food for thought, a way to speculate and to think what our future may bring us. There will be probably aspects that we already see in an embryonic stage right now. When we have presented the Ice Age, for example, today at the press conference, there were people saying, well, in some places we already are living in an Ice Age. So I think that, like you said, there will be pieces of these scenarios, and at that point it's not just the quality, but the quantity of which one of this scenario will shape up the situation in which we will be living.
Any other comments?
I think it's the same thing. I think when we were addressing the scenarios, I think you always look at the plausibility of it, but then you realize that scenarios aren't always going to be plausible. And in fact, for the Ice Age one, it was probably the most plausible and also the most implausible. Plausible because every time you switch on the television, you see the sorts of things that may emerge and the things that we've discussed. And implausible that you think that surely we're never going to really succumb and end up in such a state.
Johan?
Yeah, no, the idea was not to come up with three likely solutions, but only to offer three directions and help the UEG to stir to once something in the middle of it, and at least to give some thoughts, yeah.
We also welcome questions or comments from the audience. I see you were jumping up.
I'm a jumpy sort of person.
Yes.
So I viewed the Golden Age with horror in the end. I've got two questions, really. First of all, in this United States of Europe, did the leaving of the EU by the UK contribute to the Golden Age?
Yes.
You don't have
the UK
to
answer. We'll be jumping in the ice.
You don't have
by
to answer that. But I was interested that the folly we currently have of investing more and more money in an unrestrained way into diagnostics to diagnose conditions that we then say are too expensive to treat, that was not recognized, and that spending on diagnostics was not constrained, so that spending on treatment could be unconstrained.
Yeah, well, of course, the scenarios do not represent the individual belief of those who contributed to their shaping and not even to the presentation. I think that the Golden Age scenario, it might look as a fairy tale, but of course it has some aspects that are also not, I'm really uncomfortable with. This very strong control of spending, like you said, for example, of treatment spending, that on the other side we are already facing today. I mean, when I go to a meeting about hepatitis C, we are no longer talking about how these drugs will work, but how we will pay for patients that need this drug.
But my point is that in the last 10 or 20 years, and in your scenario, what we've done is not constrain massive increases in spending on diagnostics. There has been no comparable attention given to that. And we go for the obvious case of reducing spending on treatment, which is clearly illogical and irrational.
You're right, although one may say that if you don't diagnose a condition, you can't treat it. So, but you are, I mean, in principle, I agree with you that there has been a disproportionate balance between these two factors. I agree.
Jaime Bosch, Barcelona. My comment would be to that what you presented is a kind of reality, a TV reality show that can have in each scenario elements of reality. But what we need is a real gold standard, what we want healthcare to be, not to figure out what the politicians want that to be or current trends of our politicians, but I think our task as influential members of the community, of the healthcare community, is to define the gold standard, what we want to be the gold standard, and press towards that gold standard being attained. So it will be my plea to go towards that.
Comment from Michael?
I don't think anybody in this room would disagree with you. The difficulty, of course, is that politicians are used to hearing about gold standards from every part of the community, from every professional discipline. We all know what a good school looks like. We all know what a good university looks like. The difficulty is that they don't find the compelling case to turn that into a policy. And I think one of the ways I look at these scenarios is to slightly shock people, to make them then become a bit more imaginative and then begin a different sort of dialogue with politics. Because at the end of the day, I think that's what we're talking about. We're talking about doctors who are deeply distrusted by their politicians and their ministers of health. I mean, we would say that, wouldn't we? And we have to get into a different way of discourse, a different sort of discourse with our political masters.
I take your point entirely. Your point is exactly, you're exact, and what you say, it's okay. But I mean that probably we can all learn when looking at inequality in the way we provide healthcare in different countries in Europe and thinking what is the best as the gold standard. And perhaps in that way we can construct better European policy towards healthcare delivery. I think politicians are the ones that make the more mistakes. These are uneducated people in terms of healthcare and in many other senses as well.
I think one of the things we're going to try and do in December when we go to Brussels with some of these ideas is to begin to open that sort of dialogue, to present, you know, some of these bad cases and some of the good cases. We've also got the compelling data in John Williams and Stephen Roberts' report that shows that the standards across Europe are still quite different in different diseases and in different places. And I think when we talk to the health commissioner, I think we will have within our discipline some very stark information, which I think he'll have to take seriously.
And finally, if I can reach, the more expensive is not necessarily the better. No. And we tend to forget that. We construct very sophisticated things that are very expensive, but not forcibly the better. So probably we need to put more intelligence in that as well.
Rolf?
Am I next? Rolf. There were two things you alluded about, but not got into depth with. And the one thing is we will know much more. We have more access to patient data analysis system, bioinformatics, biostatistics, analysis of massive data, and you didn't talk much about that. And that's one thing. The other thing is what we also will see, I'm pretty sure, is you mentioned e-health, that patient involvement will be very different from now. You just said that the patient would go through the... But I think the patient will have much more to say about his treatment or her treatment. So two things.
Johan?
Yeah, well, that's one of the things that we imagined in the Silicon Age scenario, and what I tried to say with that social media was having a big influence is that we envisioned that this would that this will be the case, that they will know much more, the patients will know much more, will want to decide much more, and will be influenced by each other much more than already today. Again, this is already happening, but in this scenario, we imagine that it's even more than now.
John had a comment as well.
I mean, all three scenarios are going to have to face up to the crisis of funding. We're just not going to have the funding to support healthcare in whatever scenario. And I think you put your finger on the way we have to address it. We have to become more efficient, and that means greater use of technology and better use of information. And there's, I don't know whether any of you have seen it, but there's a report from Volterra Partners that came out in September analyzing what the impact of technology and information from a health economic point of view, and they're predicting that the UK NHS could save a third of its budget if it became more efficient in the way you suggest.
Comment? Question from the microphone up there.
Hi, thank you very much for everyone's presentations and for a very thought-provoking discussion. We've already heard that there's huge variation in healthcare provision across Europe currently. I would argue, with Ebola being a good case in point, that we already are living in an ice age for many people across the globe. I just wondered if there was any thought given to considering social responsibility for people in other countries who are less fortunate than ourselves.
Perhaps the ice age representative can respond.
Well, I mean, I think that's obviously one of the big challenges. And I guess the real question is that social responsibility may exist, but the question is how do you transfer social responsibility to action? And I think that's what the biggest challenge is. And I'm not quite sure how one would answer that. And I guess in the Ice Age scenario, a lot of that responsibility would be with those that actually have the money behind it, and a lot of that social responsibility for the rest of society, which will need to come from there. In that scenario, particularly.
I think one of the things that did come up in our discussions was the consequences of a successful Europe combined with climate change in perhaps sub-Saharan Africa or in other parts of the globe, which would effectively suck out healthcare professionals into an expanding, growing healthcare system in Europe. And there would have to be some really quite responsible approach to where we recruit doctors and nurses and other healthcare professionals from as it becomes difficult for other communities to survive in tough areas and with less resources to mitigate against climate change. So I think we did discuss that, but I think you make a very good point. You know, what is that going to be our outreach into those areas in the future within these scenarios? And we should think about that. Thank you.
Microphone in the middle.
Philip van Houtegem from Brugge, Belgium. I enjoyed it very much. It's always very pleasant to speculate about the future, about predicting is impossible, of course. As you said already, neither of those scenarios will really happen as they were told. But I have one remark and one question. The first remark is that we don't have to be too gloomy, I think, about Europe. If you see 100 years ago, just now in October 1914, Europe just started the First World War, and everyone thought that it would be finished in 2 or 3 weeks. It didn't happen. And at that time, Europe was really the center of the world. And the healthcare system was certainly immensely little of lesser quality than it is now. Anyway, we survived 2 world wars. We started a project of unification. We had a strong system of social security. So I don't think we have to be too gloomy about the flexibility and the capability of Europe. That's just a remark that I have. The question is, what can we do about it as individual doctors? I think, well, most of us are involved in patient care and we want to do the best possible care for that individual patient on evidence-based medicine, perhaps. But can we do something about it? I heard that someone else said we are still very influential in society. I doubt that a bit. Decisions are made by very few people. Although we are live in democracies, only few people make the final decisions, I think. And can we do something about that, making individual decisions or UEG, making contacts and so on? I'm a bit more gloomy about that.
Yeah. Well, I'm happy we have a testimonial for the golden age now. And I think that there is always something to do. In terms of like pushing forward the golden age, what probably we can do is to allow our students, our fellows, to learn as much as they can at the European level, to not be afraid of having exchanges with other centers, to compare our performances with those of other centers, and to try to step up the knowledge of ourselves and also the people who are younger and who have the opportunity to work with us. It's like to push this opening of the of research, but also of course of knowledge and of training for younger people. This is possibly what we can do now, and we'll see where we are in 2040.
Do we need more doctors in politics? And if so, how should we achieve this?
Well, I'm not convinced about that.
No,
I think that what doctors should do is probably more to push their message forward rather than becoming actors in politics, but that's a completely personal point of view.
Another comment from the audience?
Thank you very much. I have enjoyed very much of these scenarios. I have a question and a sort of scenario to remodulate for us. A lesson we have learned from the experience of the White Book in Italy is that it's totally true that generally the institutions look at our studies as the Dr. Disco, as you were telling us. And so we have decided to use their data. We have asked to the Ministry of Health to have the flow data of the Ministry of Health and to reason about them. And so we have showed that the best cost effectiveness is in the hands of gastroenterologists. I think that's the major point we have for the future. The major investment we have to do for the future is to discuss with institutions about their data showing that hard outcomes are better in the hands of gastroenterologists. We have, for example, just to quote one, we have recorded one mortality data in urgent admissions for upper GI bleeding that is half in the hand of gastroenterologists in comparison with the mortality, in other words, 2% versus 5% on their data. So what we have to fight and to lobby, in a sense, with our institutions all throughout Europe is to have their data and to show them that if they invest on gastroenterologists, they will spend less and have more.
Any comments from the panel about that? Or do you agree? John?
I do agree. The danger, though, is that clinicians, doctors, employ tunnel vision and only see the world in their own environment. And we have to, if we're to do that, we have to see the world much wider than that and the impact of our services on other services and the impact of what we do on patients more widely.
Yeah, but if on the same disease you reason and you compare general internal medicine, surgery, and gastroenterology ward, just to quote an example, and you see that they have different outcomes in comparison with us,
a good example in the UK is cancer services, which have been revolutionised over the last few years, but in many ways at the expense of benign services, and we have to beware of that.
Okay. Question up there. So following on from that a bit, politicians like a zero-sum game in terms of cost. So where are you recommending that what should we do less of, and which job roles should be reduced or diminished or disappear in the next 20 years to create funding for the jobs that we want to do?
Have any discussions on that in the group?
Well, I mean, perhaps I could to follow that. I mean, I guess one of the biggest issues, I mean, I look at research funding, for example, and there's a big disparity between the impact of gastroenterology in terms of clinical impact and how much research gets pumped into it. And I think the key issue, as far as I can see, is about gathering that data and presenting that data. We've, in fact, moved on to step 3 and 4, but the very fundamental data of disease burden, of disease impact, is not gathered for a lot of conditions. If you look at functional GI conditions, for example, I think there's a lot of health economic data, a lot of patient data that needs to be gathered first, so we can actually, one, present the case more strongly, and secondly, begin to decide where we need to concentrate resources.
I mean, there is another element to this, and this is sort of slightly outside our domain, but if you look at John and Stephen's data in terms of GDP spent on health, it's a pretty wide spectrum across Europe. You know, UK is a rich country, but it's not at the top in terms of spending. So I would say there is a debate to be had with politicians about what are the priorities for spending. You know, do we in the UK, for instance, need to spend as much as we do on defence? What's the point of defending a nation that's just getting sicker and sicker and has got poorer health outcomes? I mean, it's just daft.
Yeah.
Philippe Marteau, Paris. What is a gastroenterologist in 2040? What is its job? And now we have to decide how to train our fellows, because they will be the gastroenterologists at that time. And we get pressure now to take a decision whether we have to train very specialists. I mean, why would those very specialists learn about pancreatology if they will just screen for colon cancer or just treat cancer from the left colon with endoscopy and so on? So should we still be a wide specialty or a collection of subspecialties who do not speak to each other? I really would like to have your answer, because I have to fight against pressure for us to change the way of training the fellows and the duration of the studies.
Short response from each of the scenarios.
One of the things it took me an entire day to understand is that scenario building is not forecasting. So then when we entered into this reasoning, things were actually more interesting. So what you're asking is actually forecasting, how tomorrow in 5 years. I think that you, myself, all of us should be prepared to each one of these scenarios. One where you put a patient like maybe in a box and it comes out with the diagnosis and the treatment, and another in which there will be no more gastroenterologists because there's no money, you know.
No, but for us, sorry, it's not forecasting. We have in December to decide the duration of the studies for the new gastroenterologist in France. And what we receive as a message is that, okay, usually in Europe it's 4 years. For you it's 4 years, but you ask for 2 more years because of specialized endoscopy and so on, so we stop that. And we try to explain to politicians that to train a very specialist endoscopist, a therapeutic endoscopist, it needs more than the 4 years. So how will we plan that in Europe for the next years? Otherwise, the surgeons will get rid of the polyps. That's our thing.
So we need to wrap up soon. So 2 short questions and 2 rapid answers before we wrap up this session.
The problem which I have is that neither of these 3 scenarios are basically realistic. And the reason why I'm saying this is that it seems as you have ignored the fact that within the health economics, the international health authorities and also the United Nations and also in they have a huge, huge piece of information on this, and the history is there. They predicted in the first half of the 1950s the situation on an international level of how the situation would be year 2000. The curves which they produced can basically be completely superimposed on the current situation throughout the world. Their prediction of today for 2040 is Europe will not grow. United States will probably decline, and some areas, particularly Africa, will expand rapidly. So the question is, why don't you use the fridge scenario or whatever, which means that freeze the current situation in terms of economics, in terms of development, and the only positive addition to the current economic situation of Europe is, in fact, immigration.
So that's for Michael, perhaps?
So I think this is important, because if we don't know the history, we have no future. So I think this is the most realistic scenario for Europe the coming 15 years. And the knowledge is absolutely there.
All I would say, I mean, I don't dispute that at all. And you know, there are a lot of very good professional forecasters. And we've got people forecasting, you know, 4 degrees temperature rise and 1 meter sea rise for, you know, 2080, 2090. These are forecasts. And, you know, the forecasts that you've selected, Lars, may be correct. I don't know the data. But the fact is, it isn't. Forecasts are based on current knowledge. They're not based on other variables necessarily, the sort of complex variables that you can enjoy to use when you go into a different mode of thinking. I do not think forecasting and scenario planning are in any way mutually exclusive. They're different, they can come up with different answers, and they both contribute to creative thinking about the future. They're just very different, and I think we should look at both. That will be my personal view.
Yes, I also agree that every one of the scenarios may have something realistic. But I think the future of the healthcare is in the end of politics and economy. But we have to keep in mind also that there is a very strong progress in technology, nanotechnology. You know, many companies in Silicon Valley, like Google and other big companies, are developing microprobes in order to do prevention, to do early diagnostic. No? So I think the future is in the hand also of the profit, no, of the private industry, about talking about this new technology that will give us the possibility to do prevention and early diagnosis. So I would like to know the opinion.
I mean, I guess one of the main challenges is that I totally agree that if we look at a small bubble of UEG, it's more likely than we can influence that. But one of the things that we actually work through on the scenario is that we live within a contextual environment of which we have very little control. And I guess the scenarios were designed to bring those aspects that we cannot control, that may change, that we may have no say over, that may come to influence us. And I guess that's why some of the scenarios may be are less plausible than we think, or perhaps almost impossible in our minds. However, I think it's very difficult to know how that context is going to change in the future.
With that, I would like to thank the panelists and the presenters for giving excellent presentations, for doing all this work. And before we finish this session, I think it would be appropriate for Michael to finish off and tell us a little bit what the future plans are for this, where you will take this now, and how you will present it and so forth, and what you will do with it.
Thank you, Magnus. Well, just in 1 minute, I think we see this as a live project. We don't see this as a project that's been done and finished. The debate around scenarios, I think, will continue. And most people like to refresh scenarios, so as new information or new thinking comes in, you get the opportunity to change and update and develop. The data, I think, is critical. We try and practice evidence-based medicine, but we're less good at practicing or developing evidence-based healthcare policies. And I think we've got to step into that ground as a very important, powerful European voice for gastroenterology and hepatology, and we've got to use the data we've got, and I think we need to continue to collect data prospectively so that we're always on the front foot. We are better informed than anybody else in Brussels about the business that we manage in our own hospitals and in our own clinics. Data is everything. Somehow we can bring this, I think, together, and the trick will be to try and open new sorts of conversations with not only the health commissioner and the politicians in Brussels, but to help you in your national societies to put together arguments that you can take back home to talk to your own ministers of health and ministries of health. And we should set ourselves, we heard somebody talking earlier on about setting gold standards. absolutely, we should set gold standards. We should be absolutely clear what we think is going to be in the best interests of our patients in the future and just keep quietly pushing them forward. Finally, I just want to thank all of the members of the Future Trends Committee who worked fantastically hard during the last 2 years. I can't tell you how many hours they gave to this project. And we also invited a group of younger gastroenterologists, some gastroenterologists in training, to join that group so that we had a good gender balance and good age balance. So thank you all very much, and let's continue to work on the project together in the years to come. Thank you.